On that note, good morning.
Good morning.
And even though it's not sunny out, isn't it nice we got some rain finally?
Yeah.
Yes, praise God. Okay, so this is the Sunday before 4th of July. I think you all realize that, but all of a sudden, I think I had three outfits on before I realized it. So, you know me, patriotic, so, okay. Sorry. Or not. Okay, our announcements. Altar flowers, beautiful altar flowers, are given in celebration of TJ's 20th birthday with love from his wubby, Mary Kay, and his gram. TJ is her grandson. Bible study is continuing. We will not have it this Thursday, because that is the 4th, but we will meet on the 11th and the 18th. And so it will be continued. News break. Like to have a brief meeting after church. Please stay here, not there, here, for just maybe 5 or less minutes. Just want to discuss something and hope you all stay for that.
Okay.
Okay. We drove separate, so that's okay. Okay, are there any other announcements? If not, let's turn in our bulletins. Our gathering chorus, the Blessed Be the Name, page 63. Blessed Be the Name, 63. Call to worship this morning. Today we come to witness the presence of God among us.
Today we come to recall the life of one who healed the sick.
Today we are reminded again that Jesus is Lord over all creation.
This day and every day we affirm that Christ is Lord and invite him to rule over our lives and bring us healing.
Our hymn of praise is page 139, Praise the Lord, the Almighty, 139.
Oh,
You may be seated. Please join me in the opening prayer. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of all our longings, you are the fire that kindles our hearts with hope and possibility. You fill us with desire for life, and you hear our voices, whether we shout for joy or cry out with sorrow. We trust in you and give thanks for your presence in all the stages of our life. Help us to be open to the moment of your Holy Spirit in us and in your world. You know our hurts and fears and discouragements. We are sorry when our actions and our failure to act hurts others. Forgive and heal us when we give up and allow fear and self-interest to dominate our lives. Help us when we lose sight of who we are, and forgive us when we make enemies of those you have given us. In your healing and love, draw us into rich faith, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our act of praise is Psalm 130, verses 1 through 8, on page 848. That's 848. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice.
May your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications.
If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand?
But there is courageous with you, that you may be worshipped.
I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, in the Lord's word I hope.
My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning.
O Israel, hope in the Lord, for in the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord is plenteous redemption.
And the Lord will redeem Israel from all iniquities.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please stand, if you are able, for the gospel reading from Mark 5, 21 to 43, on page 39 of your pew Bible. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered round him, and he was by the lake. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhaging stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make such a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. You may be seated.
Well, again, because we are celebrating 4th of July, I'm going to play "My Country Tis of Thee," and hopefully I will play "Star Spangled Banner" as well. We'll see.
Surprise. Thank you.
Once again, thank you, Betty. I sit very close to that instrument when she's playing, and I just want to remind you that every single one of those things looks exactly the same. So how she knows which one she's supposed to bash, I'm not sure, but we're grateful for the music that you provide. I also wanted to to remind us that this is my last Sunday of my first year of appointment. It's okay. I saw Carol Ann's face beginning to drop. But just to say, today marks my first year of being appointed to the Buddtown United Methodist Church. And I say again what I've said to you before. It's a joy and a privilege to be here, and I thank you for your partnership in mission and ministry over this past year. I want us to take some time to focus as we pray together. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for who you are, what you've done, how you impact our lives. We thank you especially for these moments, moments when we can gather together, when we can be together around your word, when we can hear what you may be saying to us. So we pray again that the words of my mouth, that the collective meditation of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. This gospel text from Mark this week includes two separate segments that are interwoven. This is done in a typically Markan manner. This technique is known as intercalation. It is found throughout Mark's gospel. No one else seems to be using it. And frankly, the scholars don't even truly understand what it is that Mark intends with this, twisting these things or threading these stories together in this fashion. But he seems to start one story, break off, and then later on carry on with that same story, as was evident in the reading that Emma offered to us. But in today's gospel, the two interwoven healing stories work together at several different levels to create, if you like, a new understanding of truth. At one level, the inserted story of the woman with a hemorrhage is a dramatic story. You see, the story is used here in this particular context to heighten the dramatic tension in the other healing story, the one that it's interrupting. The long, drawn-out development of the one story, with all the details of this woman's search for a cure over so many years, makes one almost impatient to get back to the other story, the one that we started with. And then we notice that by the time we do eventually get back to the first story, the situation has certainly gotten a lot worse as they get the message that the young girl has died. At another level, there is a suggestion that the hemorrhaging woman serves as a model of faith for Jairus. The woman's life had been filled with misery and pain. In effect, one might say that her life was full of death. Jesus' healing power delivers her from death and restores her to life. It is almost as though the bleeding woman offers to us a figurative resurrection, soon to be followed by a literal resurrection. And yet, at another level. There is the incredible contrast in these two stories between the woman and Jairus. Jairus, you will note, is referred to by name. He is identified by his status, and he appears to be a powerful and persuasive man. By contrast, the woman remains forever anonymous. She is poor. She is sick. She is unclean due to her illness. And then lastly, she's a woman. Nevertheless, what binds these two people, very different people, binds them together is their common experience of utter desperation. They come to Jesus because there is simply no other place for them to go. But let me just offer one other detail that Mark places before us in this very unusual healing. The woman's faith in Jesus' ability to heal her is so great that she believes that she only needs to reach out and touch the hem of his garment in order to receive healing. That's incredible faith. And immediately, quote, she felt in her body she was healed of her disease. We note that the text reports that Jesus had not yet by this time seen or even spoken to the woman. And yet she already knew that she was healed. Only now, after the healing happened, does Jesus sense, quote, that power had gone out of him. And now he looks around and asks his disciples, who touched me? When Jesus finally addresses the woman, the force and focus of his words to her offer a most powerful affirmation. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease. No wonder then that Mark uses this woman as a model of faith. Now, as Mark resumes his other story, the faith of this unknown, this nameless woman, is now held before the leader of the synagogue, for all of this has played out in the context of what he was looking for his own daughter. This is not a matter of making the standard higher. It's not a matter of raising the bar of faith. Rather, Mark wants us to understand that this encounter with the bleeding woman is really no interruption at all. It is instead an episode which gives new shape and direction to Jairus's experience. Mark wants us to see in the bleeding woman a magnificent example of faith, faith that encourages Jairus now to believe in a whole new way. Through her, this, quote, leader of the synagogue learns that it is not who you are that matters. What matters is how eagerly one reaches out in faith. What Jairus experienced through this unknown bleeding woman allows him to increase his own faith. In other words, as per last Sunday, to have faith in more. To now believe in a greater God. So Jesus speaks words of reassurance and encouragement to Jairus. Do not fear, only believe. There is good news for us in these interwoven stories. First, we all, each of us, need models of faith. As the bleeding woman becomes a model of faith for Jairus, so too there are models of faith for us. They may not be as ideal as the faith of this woman, but nevertheless, the robust faith of others is and can be an inspiration to us. The second thing we must learn is that we are all models of faith to others. That may come as a shock to us, but other persons on their life journey look to us for our support. They may not even ask. They may just simply reach out and touch our garments as we go by. But who we are and how we act in these different moments of our own journey make a profound difference for good or ill. This is true in all situations of our lives. We are witnesses, whether we like it or not. Each of us adds something to the reservoir of life. Either we are adding hope and love and joy, honesty and truth, civility and integrity, compassion and justice, or we bring to the reservoir of life despair and judgment and hatred. We bring selfishness, prejudice and callousness, racial and gender discrimination, a distortion of faith. Those who love and seek to serve God, they know which side they're on. That is good news. And there's still more good news. We can be sure that Jesus will encourage us just as he encouraged Jairus. As we seek intentionally to grow our own faith, and we seek to follow in the way that Jesus has set before us, there is no guarantee that our lives will be easy or safe from harm. But in all the changing scenes of our lives, whether we are up or down, we will have the strong assurance that our lives have been touched by a gracious, loving, and healing hand. And we can be sure that Jesus offers us the same encouragement that Jairus received. Not a judgment on how lacking we are in faith, but words which call out the best from each one of us. And we will have the assurance that Jesus will never leave us or forsake us. So we must pray every day that we hear these words of grace from Jesus, words of grace to an unnamed woman, and allow those words to shape our lives and the course that we follow. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn is number 351. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, 351. Please remain standing as we share together the litany for Independence Day. Lord God, source of all freedom, this day we rejoice in the memory of those who declared that life and liberty are your gift to every human being.
Help us to continue your good work begun so long ago.
Make our vision clear and our will strong.
That only in human solidarity will we find liberty.
And find justice only in the honor that belongs to every life on earth.
Turn our hearts toward the family of nations.
To understand the ways of others, to offer friendship.
And to find safety only in the common good of all.
Free us from the fear of others who may be different.
And turn us toward embracing the diversity we created. We offer these our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. It take a moment to again receive our offering, grateful always for the offerings that we get from you who gather here, but we need to remember that there are those who worship with us online. We are grateful also for their generosity in giving support and encouragement to us as we continue the goals of a mission that they share with us and we share with them. So we invite our stewards, ushers, to come forward and to receive our gifts. Lord, you have been good to us in more ways than we can remember, describe, even mention. And as we give you grateful thanks for all your goodness to us, we also want to offer thanks to you for moments like these, when we can be mindful of your gifts and be given the opportunity of responding in faith to all that you have done. So we bring these gifts, signs of our loving support, our care for you and what you have done and seek to do. We bring these gifts to you because we are partners with you in your mission and ministry. So as you receive these gifts, we pray that you will bless both gift and giver, and use all that we place before you to bring in your kingdom of peace with justice. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. As we take some time to pray, we need to recognize that there is a prayer list at the back page of the bulletin. Again, I encourage you not simply to use this for a minute or two as we gather to worship, but perhaps to include these people in your ongoing prayers. Just want to reference the fact that I had the opportunity to be with Linton earlier this week, and he is much improved from the last time that I saw him. Still no clear news about when he will come home, but those who were here last week will remember that he was hospitalized briefly because they needed to deal with a clot in his leg. And so he is, as I said, a whole lot better. And he's now sort of chomping at the bit. It's time for him to leave and get home. Some of you will know what that feels like. So keep him in your prayers. Again, we want to place Myra before you and ask that you will continue to hold her in prayer. I want you to remember that the Lions have another member of their family who needs prayer, not just the two old folks who gather with us. Now, I did not say old ducks, I said old folks. So, just want to make that clear for everyone. But so we're going to keep Steve in our prayers too. I want to ask that we will stay the course with Erin and keep her in prayer. And then I'm not sure how Ray and Paula Pearson are connected to this church family, but I...
They're friends of mine, and Ray had a stroke, and his wife is not... It's
right.
Complicated. They need prayers.
Right, and they used to be in my congregation in another church, and so I'm familiar with both of them, but know that he has been going through a difficult time of late. So I want to encourage us to keep Ray in our thoughts and prayers as well. And just want to update our friend Jack, whom we held in prayer last week, that he seems to be doing just a little better. And so some of the threat of his immediate demise has diminished a little. So the timetable has changed. For that, we are grateful. Some other concerns.
Danny and I have a good friend, Marilyn, who owns the inn in the Catskills we visit twice a year. She recently had a stroke, somewhat minor, but at 91, it's not so minor. She's improving, but she can use our prayers.
Marilyn. Yes.
Wayne Lemon and his family still need your prayers. He went into rehab this week, and the family, the whole family, really needs all the prayers they can offer to them.
Yes. Well, let's clarify that. Yes, I have an ablation that's coming tomorrow morning, actually, early. And as Erica mentioned, not too sure of which is worse, the procedure or the drive home. But but we will measure the effect carefully and report. Yes. And her name again?
Laura.
Laura. Well, let's take time now to pray together. Lord, we thank you for the encouragement and the inspiration we draw from your word. We thank you for the stories of two people, carefully interwoven, but offering us a single message about how faith can grow, faith can increase. We can have faith in more. That in the final analysis, that is a choice that each of us needs to make. But we thank you that you are always present with us, seeking to facilitate us in that direction. So we thank you for those who have been models of faith to us. We celebrate them. But then we also want to remember carefully that each of us models faith for others. Give us the kind of sturdiness of character. Give us the kind of awareness that will make us mindful of our responsibility by your grace and strength to be models for others. Today we hold before you the many persons whose names we have lifted up. You know and love each one of them. You understand their situation and their need even better than we do. So we pray for Linton and Myra. We pray for Steve. We hold before you Aaron. We ask that you will journey with Ray and also Paula. That you will continue to be with Jack Johnson, that you will be with Marilyn, that you'll continue to be with Wayne, with Laura, and yes, Lord, even me. As we place all of these persons before you, we just pray that your spirit will reach into their life experience, helping them in a new way to sense your presence, to find comfort in your presence, and ultimately to have their hope of healing and wholeness fulfilled by your grace. But today we also want to pray especially for those first responders who deal with the crises that take place all over the country. Sometimes literally down the street from us, but other times in distant places, dealing with fires, storms, slides, quakes. We pray that you keep them safe and help them to be strong, but we think also of those people where everything they seem to have worked for and built up is lost, destroyed. We understand the benefit and value of insurance, but we know that insurance can never manage to repay people for the utter destruction, not just of the physical place, but of the hopes and dreams, the memories. So we just lift those people who struggle with their losses before you. And pray that you'll help them to believe in the possibility of a new beginning. Yes, at any stage of life. And we thank you for this congregation, for this little church family. We thank you for all that happens here on Sunday morning as we gather around each other and your word. Oh, but we thank you also for those things that happen once we leave, during the course of the week, other ways in which we manifest and display our own faith and trust in yourself. Help us never to grow weary of doing what is good. So now we commend each other into the care of your love and grace. We pray again, as we always do, that your grace will be sufficient for our every need. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, number 437, This Is My Song.
Oh, God of all the nations.
Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the sharing of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Amen. Amen.